Hi, this is Pastor Tim. I want to welcome you to Living Faith Church Live. This is the next best thing to being able to have us face-to-face. Of course, it's not exactly the same, but it's the best we can do at this moment. And we thank God that we have this technology and live in this hour where we, even though we're not able to meet face-to-face right now, we are still able to convey the Word of God and be able to bless you and be able to minister the Word of God to you this morning. So I want to welcome you, those of you part of our Living Faith Church family. Thank you for tuning in. And there's information down at the bottom of this message on our YouTube channel. And, of course, those of you on Facebook are watching this as well. And you can get different information off of these different resources as well to help supplement this message. This morning, I want to just invite you to join us. And I pray that you'll get your Bible out wherever you're at and follow along in the Word of God as we look up these scriptures. Maybe you have your phone there and you're following along on your computer. You can look these scriptures up on your phone. But before we begin, let's go ahead and welcome the Holy Spirit and welcome the Father and welcome the Lord Jesus Christ into this time together. Heavenly Father, we come before you by the blood of Jesus. We come before you. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit who takes the things of Christ and makes them known to us. We thank you that he is the one who takes the deep things of God and reveals them to our hearts. We thank you again this morning that you have put a treasure inside of us in an earthen vessel, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of ourselves, who has made us able ministers of the good news of Jesus Christ, not of the letter of the law, but of the Spirit. Father, we thank you this morning as we look into the Word. We pray that we might behold wondrous things from the Word of God. And we thank you that your Word will not return void, but it will prosper in what you please, and it will accomplish the thing that you sent it to do. And Father, again, we purpose not just to hear the Word, but help us to be doers of the Word in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to begin this morning by reading 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 7 through 10, and I'm reading this out of the Passion Translation. Again, that's 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 7 through 10. This morning, I'm calling this message Discerning the Many Voices of the Hour. And Paul the Apostle is speaking here, and it says, "Even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sounds, how will it be known what is piped or played?" Verse 8, "For if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? So likewise you, unless you utter by the tongue words easy to understand, how will it be known what is spoken? For you will be speaking into the air. There are, it may be, so many kinds of languages in the world, and none of them is without significance. Therefore, if I do not know the meaning of the language, I shall be a foreigner to him who speaks, and he who speaks will be a foreigner to me." Now, the Apostle Paul is admonishing these believers to give place to the gift of diverse tongues. This is one of the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit. And he's telling them here to give place for this in such a manner that it brings the most edification or building up of the local body. And he's saying here that if we don't give words or we don't use this in a manner that brings good. In other words, if I'm just speaking in diverse tongues, but I don't have an interpretation in a corporate setting, those who hear it are not going to understand what I'm saying. And this is the context with which Paul is speaking here. And he says that in the world there are many voices or many languages. And he says that even a trumpet, if it doesn't give a clear signal, how will the army prepare for battle? We know in years gone by and not too long ago, clear up into the First World War, they had people that would ride on horses and sound trumpets to sound the charge, the battle charge. And we even know today we still have taps at the end of a day on military bases all over the world. And those trumpet sounds were made for, they have a distinct message to them. So when you hear that, when you hear the tap sound on a base, you know that it's time to stand and salute the flag. You know that it's time, that's the end of the day, so to speak. And that's what these messages are all about. If you think of a natural instrument, for instance, somebody that's never played an instrument could pick up a guitar, sit down at a piano, pick up a violin, and they could make sound with it, couldn't they? But it's not something you're going to enjoy. On the other hand, you take the same instrument with a skilled musician who is well practiced, and they can make beautiful melodies. They can make sounds and songs that are fill the heart with joy, with emotion, and stir us in ways that words can't even express. And so I believe we're living in an hour where I want to just take and borrow this concept that Paul is speaking of here, and I want to expand it a little bit this morning beyond the basic context of what he's using, because I want to talk about the distinction of voices, or the distinction of the things we're hearing in the world today. You know, the world in which we live is filled with a lot of confusion, a lot of messages, a lot of words. Someone said that, I believe it, the average person today in just a couple days' time hears more information than someone who lived in the 1800s would have heard in their entire lifetime. I mean, we know that we are bombarded with information. We are bombarded with voices, voices on the internet, voices on social media, voices through television, voices through the radio, voices of the news, voices of the economy, voices of things happening. And especially in this hour of this coronavirus that we've been dealing with, we're inundated with different voices. Some are accurate, some are inaccurate. Some bring hope and encouragement, some bring confusion, and some bring fear to people's hearts. And in every area of our lives, where we're constantly hearing information, and of course the key is how do we discern that information? Now take it beyond just the news and beyond information. Let's take it to the aspect of truth versus something that's not true. Let's take it to the aspect of fear versus faith, or trust in God versus trust in the arm of man. So we see that we are having to make choices on a regular basis, and we're having to deal with a lot of confusion and a lot of darkness. The Bible says the entire world lies under the sway of the wicked one. The entire systems of this world are in such a manner that they hold people in bondage and in darkness often, because they're run by the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, and then we call him the devil. A friend of mine recently made a post, put up a few words from the song "Carry On My Wayward Son" by the group Kansas that was very popular in the 70s, I believe it was. And this was a real popular hit song, their first big hit song, but I wanted to just share the lyrics to this from the verses of this particular song. And it says, "Once I rose above the noise and confusion, just to get a glimpse beyond the illusion. I was soaring ever higher, but I flew too high." The next verse, "Though my eyes could see, I still was a blind man. Though my mind could think, I still was a madman. I hear the voices when I'm dreaming." And then the final line is, "On a stormy sea of moving emotion, tossed about, I'm like a ship on the ocean." Now, doesn't this describe the world in which we live, the world that we find ourselves in so often? And this is really where a lot of people live their lives. We're trying to rise above the noise and confusion. We're hearing voices, but we can't understand. It says, "Though my eyes could see, I still was a blind man." You know, the Bible says that we have to be able to hear what the Spirit is saying in this hour. Merriam-Webster's dictionary uses three different, I want to give you the definition of three basic synonyms. The first word is discernment, the second word is discrimination, and the third word is perception. And Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines discernment as the accuracy as in reading character or motives, or appreciating or the discernment of known true friends. And then it gives the word discrimination, because all three of these words, discernment, discrimination, and perception, are all synonyms of one another. They basically all have the same connotation. The next one is discrimination, or this stresses the power to distinguish and select what is true or appropriate or excellent. The discrimination that develops through listening to a lot of great music. In other words, we can discriminate, is this good music or is this bad music, based on listening to a lot of good music. And finally, perception. This implies the quick and often sympathetic discernment as of shades or of feelings. So we have discernment, discrimination, and perception. These three words all work together. So what are we talking about when we're talking about discernment? The Bible uses the word discernment a lot. The word to discern truth from darkness. The word to live a life of discernment. Meaning that we're able to look at something and we're to make a choice between is this right or is this wrong. That we make accurate, godly choices about everyday life and the things we are facing. Now, throughout the Word of God, especially in Jesus' address to the seven churches of the Revelation, in the book of Revelation, Jesus addresses each one of these churches with the word, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches." Seven times he makes this statement, "He who has an ear, let him hear." Now, obviously, he's not talking about if you have ears on the side of your head. But what he's really referring to here is if you have an attitude and a heart to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. If you are discerning, if you are willing to hear, if you have a heart that is attuned to what the Holy Spirit is saying. So this is what he's really referring to here. Vincent's word study says that this phrase, "he who has an ear," is always used of radical truths, great principles, and promises. So this is the connotation or the context in which this phrase is used. In Isaiah chapter 6, verses 8 through 10, out of the complete Jewish Bible, the prophet Isaiah was sent to the nation of Israel because Israel had fallen into apostasy, a lot like what we're dealing with in the United States today. Israel was prospering, but in the middle of their prosperity, the northern kingdom had fallen completely into wicked idolatry, and southern Judah, the other two tribes of Judah, although they had an outward conformity to the word of God and truth, they were basically corrupt. The priesthood was corrupt. There was a lot of idolatry going on in Israel. People neglected their families, and their worship to God was basically lip service, but there wasn't a lot of true heart devotion in their worship. The Bible says, "These people draw near me with their mouths, but their hearts are far from me." And God was calling for judgment on the nation because of their wickedness and their sin. And this is what Isaiah the prophet is sent to the nation to speak. And it says here, this is the complete Jewish Bible, Isaiah chapter 6, verses 8 through 10. "Then I heard the voice of Adonai," or the voice of the Lord, "saying, whom should I send? Who will go for us? I answered, I am here, send me. He said, go and tell this people, yes, you hear, but you don't understand. You certainly see, but you don't get the point. Make the heart of this people sluggish with fat. Stop up their ears and shut their eyes. Otherwise, seeing with their eyes and hearing with their ears, then understanding with their hearts, they might repent and be healed." Now, this seems like a bit of a contradiction. Wouldn't you think that God wants them to repent and be healed? Wouldn't you think God would want them to turn? But this is not what he's really referring to. What he's really saying is, if you have ears to hear, just like Jesus is saying to the churches of Revelation, because in the message to the churches of the Revelation, several of those churches were commended by the Lord Jesus Christ, while a number of them were rebuked by the Lord Jesus Christ. One particular church, he says, "I gave you time to repent. I gave her time to repent, but because she won't repent." So the idea here behind this is when our hearts are repentant and we have ears to hear, we have a teachable heart, we want to know the truth of the Word of God, we want to know what God is saying to us, then the Word of God will come to us and we will turn to the Word of God, we will turn away from what is dark, we will turn away from the lie, and we'll follow after God. But those who have no ears to hear, those who are stubborn and full of human arrogance and pride, those who refuse to repent, the hard-hearted, literally, when they hear the word of the Lord, when they hear this word, their ears won't hear, and their eyes they will not see. Amen. This is what Jesus said in Matthew's Gospel, the 11th chapter, the 15th through the 17th verse. And Jesus is literally quoting from Isaiah the prophet, and he's relating it to the generation which he lived, among which he lived during his earthly ministry. And he says, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to what shall I liken this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to their companions and saying, we played the flute for you and you did not dance. We mourned for you and you did not lament. So what does this mean? Well, he's basically saying we've done whatever we needed to do to get you to hear, but if we sing sad songs, you won't lament. If we sing joyous songs, you won't rejoice. So what's the problem here? The problem is they don't have an attitude to hear. The problem is they will not hear. They're like the people in Isaiah's time, that they have hard hearts. They're dull of hearing. And Isaiah says in Isaiah chapter 59, in Isaiah chapter 59, verses 14 and 15, truth stumbles in the streets and honesty has been outlawed. Yes, truth is gone and anyone who renounces evil is attacked. Does that sound a lot like today, folks? Does it sound like where America has fallen to, that there are so many people in this nation today that they don't have ears? They don't want to hear the truth, and truth is fallen in the streets and even outlawed. Boy, we can certainly see that around us today where this idea of political correct speech and not being able to say certain things that might offend somebody is really prevalent in our society. And this was the very condition that was taking place during the day, during Isaiah's day, that the people, while they should have been hearing and heeding the voice of the Lord, they were hearing and heeding the voice of human beings. They did not want to hear the truth. And when people stood up to speak the truth and proclaim the righteousness of God, they were viciously attacked in the name of the age and the hour. So, in Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 12, Jesus here again is referring to the same thing. He who has an ear, let him hear. And he says here in Mark's Gospel, the 4th chapter, the 12th verse, and I'm reading this out of the Expanded Bible. I like this translation. It's just a little more, as it refers to it, it's a descriptive translation. And it says, so they will look and look, but they will not learn. They will listen and listen, but they will not understand. If they did learn and understand, they would come back to me and be forgiven. So here again, Jesus is referring to Isaiah the prophet, and he's using the same connotation. He's saying these people, they look for the truth, but they don't see the truth. They learn, but they don't understand. Their hearts are dull. And exactly, this is what we're referring to. This is what Isaiah was talking about. And I'm concerned that this is really where we're at in our society today. The people in our country are learning. They don't have a heart for truth for the most part. The truth is becoming something that the people don't discern. The truth is relative. It's whatever I want truth to be. Truth is subjective to my own personal interpretation or my own personal feelings. We're living in what's called a post-Christian, post-modern era where truth is anything I want it to be. And how dangerous this was in Isaiah's day and how dangerous it is in our day as well. Amen. So the Apostle Paul warned that this would be the condition before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, the Amplified Bible says, for the time will come when people will not tolerate sound doctrine and accurate instruction that challenges them with God's truth, but wanting to have their ears tickled with something pleasing, they will accumulate for themselves many teachers, one after another, chosen to satisfy their own desires and to support the errors they hold. So this was what the Apostle Paul said would be the condition before the second coming of Christ, that there would come a season where people had no heart for truth, where people did not want to tolerate what was true. And he said this would be a, you know, part of the great apostasy or the falling away that would come before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not saying this to preach gloom and doom to you. Lord knows that we need to hear encouragement in this hour in which we're living. But this does have to do with learning to discern what is truth as opposed to what is a falsehood. We're living in an age where God's people must have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. So many of God's people are led by the news media, which cannot be trusted. So many of God's people are led by the reports of man. If man reports things are bad, they're just as fearful as the world around them. They're just as worried about the world around them. And this should not be, brothers and sisters in Christ. We must hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. We must hear what God is saying, not what man is saying. And unfortunately, there are many Christians that are complying to the culture around them because they're hearing the wrong voices. They're just like the people in Isaiah's day, that we played the harp for you and you didn't lament. We danced for you and you wouldn't dance. We did all of these things and you wouldn't respond. Why wouldn't they respond? Because their hearts were dull and their ears were closed and they had departed from the truth of the Word of God. Isaiah said, "My people have gone into captivity because they have no knowledge." Well, what was the knowledge they lacked? They lacked the knowledge of the covenant of God and the truth of the Word of God. They had turned their hearts away from hearing God's Word, and as a result of this, they had been turned unto fables of men's fancies. Amen. So we must have a heart of understanding. We must have a heart that hears what the Spirit of God is saying, and we must be able to discern in order to guard our hearts against the things of this world. If you read the book of Proverbs, which is specifically the only book in the entire Bible that is specifically addressed to young people, we would say it's addressed to teenagers. It's written for young people so that they can have discernment. They can learn what to do in life. Now, Proverbs is a fantastic book. There's 31 chapters of Proverbs. So that means you could read one chapter of Proverbs every day as your daily devotional. You could spend one chapter every day, 31 days in the month, and then start over every month. And you can live your life out of the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs tells you how to make wise choices. The book of Proverbs admonishes you not to hang out with foolish people and how to deal with foolish people. It's a fantastic book when it comes to just relationships. It has a lot to say about how to handle money. It has a lot to say about staying away from people who will destroy your lives, wicked, foolish people. It has a lot to talk about parents and children and how they're to respond to their parents and just life in general. It is a book of wisdom. It will fill your heart with wisdom and understanding and knowledge. And the Word of God says the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. Get wisdom, get understanding, get knowledge, and in all you're getting, get understanding. So in Proverbs chapter 2, this is the admonition of a father to his young son. And in verse 11 through 16, it says, "Discretion will watch over you." Now again, we defined that word discretion earlier. Discretion is the ability to discern things. Discernment, discretion are basically similar words. They're synonyms. They mean the same thing. If you have discretion, you have discernment. If you have discernment, you have discretion. So it says, discretion will watch over you. Understanding and discernment will guard you. So discretion means you look at things and you have the sense or the wisdom to not take a certain path that you shouldn't take. The Bible says a beautiful woman who lacks discretion is like a gold ring in a pig's snout. What does that mean? It means that if you could have a beautiful woman or a handsome man, but if they're loose with their lives, it's like putting a gold ring in a pig's snout. And we certainly see that. I mean, Hollywood would be a great example. Hollywood today, you have beautiful women and you have very handsome men, but many of these people live a very ungodly life. And it's like putting a gold ring in a pig's snout. It's inappropriate. It just doesn't fit. And that's what it's saying. So discretion gives you the wisdom to do things that fit. Like the Bible says, as apples of gold and pictures of silver, so is wise counsel from a distant land, or good words from a distant land. They refresh the soul. So this is what it's referring to here. And it says, discretion will watch over you. That means it will guard you. It'll watch you. Understanding and discernment will guard you. So discernment is the ability to make right choices, right? You discern. We should do this. We shouldn't do this. We should listen to this. We shouldn't listen to that. It's so important that we as God's people have godly discernment, that we can discern what is right and what is wrong, what is truth versus what is a lie, what is godly versus what is ungodly. It's an unfortunate thing that many of God's people in this hour can't seem to discern what's truth versus what's not true, what the world says versus what is not the world. I hear people all the time who profess to be Christians, and yet they espouse things that are completely contrary to the Bible. What does that tell me? Tell me, it tells me that either they are not believers and do not have the Spirit of the living God in them, or they are completely void of the truth of the Word of God and the discernment and discretion that comes from the truth of the Word of God. Amen. So it says here, understanding and discernment will guard you to keep you from the way of evil and from evil men. What will discretion, what will discernment do? It will keep you from the path of evil, and it will keep you from evil people, people that want to do wickedness. In other words, you don't go down that path. Blessed is he who walks not in the path of the scornful, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. We don't want to go down the path of the wicked. The Bible admonishes us this a number of times, to stay away from the ways of the wicked. Stay away from the paths of sinners, of people who are walking in darkness and doing things contrary to the Word of God. From the man who speaks perverse things. Boy, we could certainly hear that in this culture today. Verse 13, from those who leave the paths of uprightness. Do you notice this connotation? Those, it'll keep you away from those who leave the path of uprightness. What does that mean? It'll keep you away from those who leave the ways of God, basically, to walk in the ways of darkness. There are a lot of people today that have left their first love, that have left the ways of God, and they're walking out in paths of darkness. I'm sad to say that there are even a lot of professing preachers today that are preaching things that are contrary to the truth of the Word of God. I mean, I'm not just talking about something we disagree with doctrinally. I'm talking about they're denying the Lord Jesus Christ. They're proclaiming things that simply are forbidden in Scripture and admonished or rebuked in Scripture, and yet they're embracing them and teaching other peoples to do the same. So, from those who leave the path of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. Verse 14, who find joy in doing evil and delight in the perversity of evil, whose paths are crooked. Whenever the Word of God refers to crooked paths or crookedness, it's referring to taking something that is right and twisting it or perverting it. In Romans chapter 1, the Apostle Paul refers to the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Well, what does that mean? It means they take Scripture, they take truth, and they twist it and pervert it. This would be much like Satan, the serpent in the Garden of Eden, who said to Eve, when he said, has not God said that you can eat of every tree in the garden? And Eve says, well, he said, we can eat of every tree except the tree that is in the middle of the garden. We can't eat that tree, and we shouldn't touch it, or we will die. And the devil, the serpent, says, you won't die, for your eyes will be open, and you'll be like God, knowing evil and good. So what is the devil doing there? What is the serpent doing? He's twisting what God says. He's, first of all, he's saying, God said you can eat of every tree, right? Just like the devil did with Jesus when he was in the wilderness, and he said, the Lord said, cast yourself down from here, for it's written, he will give his angels charge over you to lift you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. That's right out of Psalm 91. But Jesus rebukes the devil and said, it is also written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God, nor shall you put him to the test. So thank God Jesus knew the Word of God better than the devil knew the Word of God. But what was the devil doing? What was he doing in both those examples? He was twisting truth. And we live in a world today where we have people that are masters at twisting the truth. And why do they twist the truth? Because their father is the devil. Jesus said to the Pharisees, the religious leaders of his day, he said, you are of your father, the devil. He was a liar from the beginning, and there's no truth in him. Everything he speaks is a lie. So people who are liars and deceivers, and they twist the truth, they take what is truth, and they turn it and twist it around so that the darkness seems like light, and the light seems like darkness. What is right seems wrong, and what is wrong now is declared right. This is what the Bible refers to as crooked paths, or holding the truth in unrighteousness, or twisting the Word of God. And it says in verse 15 here, whose paths are crooked and who are devious in their ways, to keep you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words. Now the immoral woman here is referring, it's metaphoric in what it's, because this is spoken to a young man, and it's metaphoric, but what's it meaning? The immoral woman doesn't mean just sexual immorality or some woman that is immoral sexually. It can mean that, but it has a greater connotation. It means from paths that lead you into immoral living. This is what discernment, this is what discretion, this is what the Word of God will do in our lives. Psalm 119 says, "How shall a young man cleanse his ways? By giving heed to your word, O Lord." So the way we walk in paths of righteousness, the way we have godly discernment, the way we have godly discretion is by learning to listen to the Word of God and the Spirit of the living God. Amen. We hear a lot in our culture today, one of the favorite statements that we constantly hear is, judge not, don't judge or you're going to be judged. This is a favorite scripture. It seems to be the only scripture that a lot of lost people, a lot of non-believers seem to understand. And we hear this all the time. And this becomes such a blanket statement and so misused that even many of God's people don't understand the implication of this statement. Of course, this is in Matthew's Gospel, the 7th chapter, when Jesus was speaking of judging. And he says, don't judge or else you will be judged. And he goes on here to say and talk about judging hypocritically. And it says here, do not judge and criticize and condemn others unfairly with an attitude of self-righteous superiority as though assuming the office of a judge. Well, why? Because God is the judge. Amen? So that you will not be judged unfairly. For just as you hypocritically judge others when you are sinful and unrepentant, so will you be judged. And in accordance with your standard of measure used to pass out judgment, judgment will be measured to you. Why do you look at the insignificant speck in your brother's eye, but do not notice and acknowledge the egregious log that is in your own eye? That's Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 2. So what is Jesus referring to here? He's saying, don't go judging other people and look down your nose at them as if you're somehow morally superior to them when you're doing the very things you're judging them about. And isn't this really the case? A lot of people do this. And this is what the Bible defines as hypocrisy. Don't judge hypocritically. In other words, don't look at somebody and judge them in their immoral behavior, ungodly behavior, when you're doing the very same thing they're doing. And a lot of people do this. And this is the kind of judgment that Jesus is referring to. He's referring to hypocritical judgment. But in no way, shape, or form was Jesus making some type of blanket statement here that God's people should never judge anything. You know, we are to make right judgments. No moral, godly society can survive if we don't make judgments. We make judgments all the time based upon God's truth. For instance, we have a judgment in the Word of God that says, you shall not murder, or you shall not commit a murder. And murder, pretty much in any society I've ever seen, is pretty much against the law. Why? Because it's a moral judgment. And all of our laws are basically moral judgment. Somebody said you cannot legislate morality. Well, I understand the connotation that you can't make people be godly by law. You can't pass laws that are going to force people into living godly lives. It just will not work. But the Bible says that the law was made for the ungodly. That is why you have law. Because if the people were not ungodly, you wouldn't need law. But laws were made for the wicked. But let me just make it very clear. There is no such thing as a law that doesn't have a moral implication. All laws have moral implications. So the idea that that we shouldn't have a moral standard in passing law is simply nonsense. Because all laws are bringing forth somebody's morality. It's just a matter of whose morality they're bringing forth. So we have to really be clear about that. But the Bible is clear that we are to make judgments. We are to discern, because what we're talking about is making moral discernment. We're to discern things. Matthew 24, verses 4 through 5, and Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. So why would Jesus say something like that to his disciples and, of course, to us? Be careful that no one deceives you. Well, the way we are careful that not being deceived is by making right choices, by making moral observations, by discerning what is true versus what is lies, what is right versus what is wrong, what is godly versus what is ungodly. So it's an impossible thing and really a silly idea that we don't make moral judgments. We make moral judgments all the time, and our moral judgments as God's people and as a society should be based upon the Word of God, the truth of the Word of God. So how exactly do we develop in this? How do we grow in our discernment and growing in our walk with God? Well, of course, first and foremost, I think the most important thing is we need to make sure we have a relationship with God. I mean, we need to make sure we're abiding in the vine, that we're remaining hooked into Christ on a daily basis, in a moment-by-moment basis, because you're either going forward with God or you're going away from God. So we need to make sure that we judge ourselves on a daily basis. The Bible says if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. So we have to make discernments about our own lives. Where am I at today with Christ? Where am I at? Where's my life at with Christ? Am I walking with Christ? Or am I living out in the world? Am I trying to straddle the fence? Am I like the church at Laodicea? I'm neither hot nor cold. I'm trying to live a Christian life, but at the same time, I'm basically playing with fire out here in the world, doing things that I know in my heart are sinful. Well, that's a dangerous place to be, because it's going to open the door for the devil to hurt you. And if you're not careful, it can open the door for the devil to deceive you, because basically you're already on the brink of deception because your heart is hardened to the lies that you're embracing and the sin that you're embracing. You're trying to make excuses for it, and that's an ungodly place to be, and it's a dangerous place to be. So first and foremost, you have to stay hooked into the vine so that the life of Christ is abiding in you, so that His Spirit is abiding in you, so that when the Spirit of God moves in your heart and convicts you, you're easily moved away from sin. You're easily moved away from the darkness. The Bible speaks about people's hearts being seared as with a hot iron. So the more we participate in sin and darkness, when you do something wrong, it might really bother you at first. But if you continue to do that same thing over and over, it'll get to the point where it doesn't bother you at all. And I'm concerned that this is it's where our culture has gone, and it's even where the church has gone in America today, where we begin to wink at sin, and we wink at the things, and we play games with sin, and we act as if it's not a big deal, that it's okay, it's a weakness I have. No, it's called a sin I have, and we need to repent and recognize it as such and turn away from it. Amen. So how can we insulate ourselves from the lies of the world? How can we insulate ourselves from being deceived and the deception in the world? By abiding in the vine. I don't know about you, but most people probably never seen a counterfeit $20 bill. You know, if I were to see a $20, I've seen fake counterfeit $20 bills, but only on a couple of occasions. And if you look at them very closely, you can say, okay, the paper is a bit different and so on, because it's U.S. currency. It's the paper that U.S. currency is made on that is one of the most distinguishing aspects about our money. But If you are not really versed in studying and understanding real money versus counterfeit money, it would be very easy, because we're handling money all the time, it would be very easy for us to be deceived, to take fake or counterfeit money, and we wouldn't recognize it. But the way we know what is real versus what is not real is not by spending time studying the fake, it's by spending time studying the real. Because when you're really familiar with the real, then the fake becomes very apparent. When you are discerning and you have spent a lot of time discerning the truth of the Word of God, then the falsehood of the world becomes glaringly apparent. We have a lot of voices in the world today proclaiming things that are just, they sound spiritual, they sound biblical, they sound spiritual and like, oh, this sounds really good. But when you line it up with the truth of the Word of God, it doesn't match at all. This is like using a plumb line in building or using a level in building or a square. You know, you can look at something with your eye. You say, that looks pretty square or that looks pretty level. Put a level on it and you see it's off. And you know, if you're off a little bit here and you continue to run off, it's going to get worse and worse and worse. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. A little yeast worked into your life in the way of sin can eventually lead to dire consequences. It's the little foxes that spoil the vine, so to speak. So we have to learn how to insulate ourselves from the lies of the world by spending time with the real. And of course, that's the Word of God, the Bible, and God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the other way I believe that one of the more practical ways that we insulate ourselves from the things of the world is spending time with God's people. I think it's important that we as God's people are around God's people. Because most of us work, you know, most people work out in the world. You're working around people that are lost. We're living in a fallen world, and we're out constantly and bombarded and surrounded in a pagan, ungodly, wicked culture that's calling things that are wicked righteous and calling things that are righteous wicked. We live in a society today that is trying to convince us that the sins of the world should be accepted by everyone and every sort of ungodly behavior is just fine and there's something wrong with you if you don't accept this. And we're constantly bombarded with lies, whether it's the lie of evolution, whether it's the lie of LGBTQ or sexual immorality or pornography or just every sort of deception that we're being bombarded with in this culture today. Where God's people are being deceived into believing things that are simply not scriptural. And the reason, because they are not around enough of God's people who are holding the truth dear to their hearts. You know, the Bible says that if you desire to be wise, walk with the wise, because a companion of fools will be destroyed. That's just simply true. If you want to be godly, walk with godly people. Now, this doesn't mean we shouldn't be friends of sinners. Jesus was a friend of sinners. But the Bible also says don't be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. This means don't have real close, intimate relationships with people on a solical basis with people who are ungodly, because if they will have an influence on your life. It's easier for the wicked to corrupt the righteous than it is for the righteous to bring the wicked to righteousness, because the influence of the ungodly will affect your life. The Bible says a righteous man should choose his friends carefully, because the ways of the wicked will lead them astray. We are seeing this in our universities today. We're seeing this in our high schools today, where young people who are coming out of Christian homes, pretty soon they're out living in the world because of the pressure that's put on them, the fear of man that's put upon them to live just like the rest of the world, to be involved with things the rest of their friends are involved with. And what does the devil do? He pressures them so that we will comply. This is how the devil works. He puts pressure on you to conform to the society, to bend to the world, to bend to what the world's doing. And if you don't do it, then you're considered an outcast, you're mocked, you're ridiculed, or you're persecuted in some other way. So the way to insulate ourselves from this thing is, first and foremost, spend time with God and His Word. But the next thing is to spend time with God's people. Be around godly people. You know, as a pastor, I admonish you to be involved with a good local church. Now, I remember that I know that we live in a society today, and see, this is one of the deceptions that has taken root in Christians' lives today, this notion, this really non-biblical notion that, well, church is not that important. You know, I can get everything I get on church by just watching preachers on television, or I can just stream church online. Now, I realize that, thank God we have this available to us today, that people can hear the Word of God just from their own homes, but I just want to assure you, as good as that is and as much of a blessing as it is, it's not the same thing as being there organically. It's not the same as being face-to-face. I mean, we're seeing a society today that although we're connected through the internet, we have Facebook, we have all of these formats, instant messengers, all these different ways of being connected to the world, and yet people are lonely. People feel more isolated today than they've ever felt. Why? Because the internet is not the same. It is simply not the same. There is just something that you cannot have over a webcast that you can have face-to-face and person-to-person. You know, that'd be like saying, well, I married my wife and we did our vows over the phone, over the internet, and we've never really gotten together. We don't physically see each other. We haven't consummated our marriage and so on, but we're married. Well, what kind of relationship is that? What kind of relationship would that be? Well, internet relationship. Well, it's not the same as being physical. It's not the same as being there face to face. There is something within the human body that God put His Spirit within you, and He has a gift within you. And thank God that we can connect this way. And I'm not saying that this is totally bad, but don't replace this for being face to face. Now, right now, because of this virus and government mandates, we're meeting like this, but this is only going to be a short time. And in a few weeks, we're going to be back together. Whether the government mandates or not, we're going to be back together because we're not going to have church this way for the rest of our lives and not for the rest of this year. I will guarantee you that. And whether you like that or not, it's just the fact. This is not the same as being face to face. Praise be to God. And so we need people around us that can speak into our lives, that can challenge our faith, to encourage us, that can admonish us to walk with God. We need people that will speak hard truth into our lives. We need people that will pray with us to help us. The Bible says you are strong, bear the burdens of the weak, and you just can't get that on your own. The Bible says God has put these in the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints, so the saints can do the work of the ministry and the body of Christ can be edified. We are a body, and we're called a body, and we're called to be organically connected to other people within the body. So the idea or the notion that somehow you can live your Christian life in isolation apart from being part of a local church or being part of a local body in some respect physically is just simply nonsense. It's not biblical. It's a modern myth, and it's nothing we ever find in the Bible, and we shouldn't imagine it. This cannot replace being there present. It just will not. As much as people want to imagine it will, it simply will not. And thank God we have it again. Thank God this is a supplement, but it was never intended to replace being face-to-face. And I admonish you because I know there are a lot of people that don't go to church, don't attend a church. Some people, because they can't, because of distance, maybe they just are in a situation they can't, or there's not a church in their vicinity, or whatever the case may be. I understand that. I understand maybe people work and they have obligations where it makes it difficult for them to be in church, but somehow you must be connected to a local body in some capacity. Amen. And finally, let's wrap it up here this morning. We must have a love of the truth of the Word of God. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9, it says, "When this man who avoids Torah, the Antichrist, the adversary will give him the power to work all kinds of false miracle signs and wonders." Paul speaking of this man of perdition, the man of Antichrist, who's coming into the world. "He will enable him to deceive in all kinds of wicked ways those who are headed for destruction." And why? Because they would not receive the love of the truth that could have saved them. This is why God is causing them to go astray, so that they will believe the lie. The result will be that all who have not believed the truth but have taken pleasure in wickedness will be condemned. Do you see the similarity? Do you see the parallelism here in what Paul said in Thessalonica to the church at Thessalonica, to what Isaiah the prophet was saying about not, you know, we've heard the word of God, we've heard the truth, but we've turned away from it. Do you see the parallelism that he who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church? The same connotation. So that people continue to harden their hearts and people continue to turn away from the truth, God will allow delusion into their lives. God will allow deception into their lives. And this is the working of their own hands, not the working of God. So this morning, as we wrap this up this morning, I want to thank you for tuning in. I pray that this word has touched your heart, that it's spoken something into your heart, and it's challenged you where you're at in your Christian walk today. Or maybe you're not a Christian, but you're watching today, and you've never received Christ as your Savior. So I want to admonish you today to turn to Christ. I want to admonish you today to surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no name given among men whereby we must be saved than the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So today I want to just offer to pray with you to surrender to Christ. If you are a Christian and you've been walking out in the world and you've been living in darkness and you know it, you know that you're not where you need to be with God, I want to give you an opportunity to turn back. And maybe you're here today, you're listening to this today, and you've never surrendered your life to Christ. Maybe you've heard what the Spirit is saying to you today, and there's this choice, and you're battling right now, should I surrender, should I not surrender? Well, the Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. So today is your day. Today is the opportunity. Life is short, life is frail, and life is uncertain. But there's one thing we do know, that there is an eternity. And we will live beyond the grave, either in heaven or we will live in hell. The choice is us. Behold, I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that you may live. God loves you and loved you so much that he sent his son that you could be saved. So I want to pray with you today. This prayer, again, is not going to necessarily save you unless you follow up from this prayer and you continue to live a life that you have prayed about. You can say this prayer and go out from your place and go back into the living in the world in darkness and sin, and it will not do anything in your life. But if you pray this and you ask God sincerely and surrender your life to Christ, and then you follow up by living for Christ, by following after him, by doing the things that I admonished you, you will be saved. Christ will be formed in you. So I want to give that opportunity right here today. Heavenly Father, say this with me. Bow your head and say this with me. Heavenly Father, I believe I am a sinner. I believe I have sinned against you. I have broken your commandments. And I have been lawless without your law. I repent. I turn from my sin. I believe you raised Jesus from the dead after he was crucified, and that he's seated in heaven with you right now. And according to what I believe, I confess that Jesus Christ is now my Lord. I surrender. I surrender. I surrender my life to God. Take my life. Make me a brand new person inside. And from this day forward, I will live for you with all of my heart, with all of my soul, and with all of my strength. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer this morning, I'd urge you to go down and check on the link and go to our website and send us a message on our get and contact us and let us know that you prayed that prayer. You could just say, or even down here in the comment section, we'd urge you to leave comments. So please find a good local church and get involved. We have several links there to our website, to our Facebook page. If you'd like to help us out with an offering, we would appreciate that. If no pressure there, but there's a link there. We'll take you to our website, and you can give via PayPal, or you can give through the Givelify app that's there. They're both secure. Or if you want to just send a check, send it to Living Faith Church, P.O. Box 65, Excellent, Wisconsin, 54835, Excellent, E-X-E-L-A-N-D. So thank you again for tuning in today. Blessings upon you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you again. Bye-bye.